Teşekkür ediyoruz. Çok güzeldi. Çok güzel bir girişti. Teşekkürler, teşekkürler. Well, I want to welcome all our participants. I think we have a significant amount of participants. We're in good shape. We're in good shape. Okay. After a touch of music, let me do a bit of an introduction, and then we'll continue with our mini concert. Well, okay. Evet, şimdi başlayabiliriz. Her zaman söylerim, beni tanıyan dostlarım bilirler. Önce yönümü bulmak için kendi dilimde, ana dilimde birkaç söz söylerim. Efendim, hoş geldiniz. Dear participants from Turkey, Finland, and all over the world, distinguished representatives of the Turkish and Finnish business communities, all attendees, and of course, dear speakers, for making this very important, and in my opinion, yet another significant message-emitting content-spreading webinar possible in the midst of passionate vitality of springtime. I want to call this whole event Composing Smart Startups with Lyrics of Innovation. Truly, for an effective smart startup, we need innovation. And what we're trying to do here as the Turkey-Finland Business Council of the Foreign Economic Relations Board of Turkey, DEİK, we're trying to create a new horizon for Turkish-Finnish collaboration. Collaboration so that the startup ecosystem and the early stage investments can be better known, better applied, better utilized over the what we call North-South Corridor. Yes, it is indeed my absolute pleasure to welcome you all today as the chairman of DEİK's Turkey-Finland Business Council. It'll be an exciting webinar with all our participants and the great speakers. And we are very lucky that we have a very special gentleman, Professor Ali Rıza Kaylan, Professor Emeritus of Boğaziçi University, and also the founder and co-chair of a program that I really love in that great university, Engineering Technology and Management Master's Program. Istanbul is a very special city, especially in the time of spring. Istanbul. Trees are in full blossom. Sun is shining right now. Even though this morning there was a bit of a hide and seek with the clouds, with the beautiful clouds. But there was lovely wisterias. They're naturally painting images of falls like waterfalls. And Julius trees undulating the hills along the shores of our impressively beautiful Bosphorus. What a time of the year. And I know in Helsinki, now you have more daylight. Everything is coming back with that kind of vitality. It's springtime. We have startups, we have innovation, but where's the entrepreneur? Without the entrepreneur, that spirit, that kind of vitality, how can we start a startup? How can we make use of innovation? Spring is a time for growth. Spring is a time for growth. Do you want to grow? Freedom exists for those willing to keep evolving. Clean your soul mirror until it reflects the light. Don't wear worn out secondhand opinions. Know for yourself, for yourself. Don't chase shadows. Embrace the mystery. Don't just admire the jug. Drink that water. Drink that water. Don't wait for tomorrow. Right now is all. Right now is all. Dive into the river of transformation and swim to the ocean. So this is our great philosopher, poet, mystic, Mevlana Celaleddin Rumi. What a way to describe all the talents and the characteristics of an entrepreneur. Timing, will, continuous change, renewal, creativity, knowledge, experience. Don't be a me too guy. Think with originality and take risks, embrace the mystery. Drink the water, do it and act now. Implement, adaptively change and be a leader in action. Ladies and gentlemen, this is what I want to tell about composing smart startups. And in the meantime, make sure that you use the lyrics of innovation. Thank you very much again. Thank you very much. Welcome to our webinar. Thank you. Evet Emrullah'cığım, girişimizi yaptık. Gene Mevlana ile yaptık. Bahar büyüme zamanıdır der biliyorsun. Senelerdir bunu hep söylüyoruz. Ama soruyor sana Mevlana'mız. Kardeşim büyümek istiyor musun? Önce o istek, o arzu. Hadi bakalım. Ne güzel başladınız, ne güzel başladınız. What a start in springtime. Thank you. Şimdi ne yapıyoruz?
Efendim şimdi Türk marşı çalalım size. Mozart'ın.
Hadi bakalım, hadi bakalım. Teşekkür ediyoruz. Sağ olun, var olun. Ve tam da zamanlamamız da çok iyi. Bilmiyorum, repertuarda var mıydı başka bir şeyler Ebrullah'cığım?
Nihamet Lomba çalalım. Aras Mavri'yi isterseniz.
Ya da şöyle yapabilir miyiz? İsterseniz Ali Rıza Hocam'a bir söz verelim. Ali Rıza Hocam birinci konuşmamızı takdim etsin. Ondan sonra böyle bir 20 dakika sonra bir Nihamet Longa ondan sonra da bitirebilir miyiz? Olur mu?
Tabii ki.
Tamam. Okay. Now we can officially start with our speakers and then in between somewhere, whenever it feels like it, we will have one more piece and we'll thank our musicians and we'll let them go. Okay, thank you. So, without further ado, I'd like to introduce Professor Ali Rıza Kaylan, who is a wonderful gentleman. I've known him for many years. We're proud of Professor Kaylan. And I've already told him some of his credentials. We've done things together. In 2008, when I was elected the chairman of Turkey Film Business Council, about 3 weeks later, we had a special presidential visit to Finland. And the theme of the Business Council's meeting was Turkish innovation meets Finnish innovation. And Ali Rıza Hocam was there with me. And we had some great speakers, and that was our start. Now, without further ado, Ali Rıza Hocam, Dr. Kaylan, the screen is yours in any way. Please, Hocam, buyurun lütfen.
Thank you, Halil Bey, sevgili Halil Bey. Well, I am deeply honored, really, to be the moderator for such a wonderful web-based presentations, workshop, whatever we call it, and a very important topic. I'm sure we will all learn from our great speakers from a leading country, Finland, in this entrepreneurship area, innovation area. As Halil Bey mentioned, really, every time, I believe it has been about 10 meetings I have attended together with Halil Bey in this line, and all of them are so enjoyable. I cannot really, probably it is the cultural taste also, not only the taste coming from the speakers, but we are very thankful to our great performers, really the meeting of the musicians, the performance. In the past, we had also performance from Finland side also. It is great. Without, well, at the end, we will have a Q&A session, probably it may last more than 15 minutes. So please, let's keep our questions to the end. The first speaker, without further ado, Mr. Petri Lane, a partner in Investor Ventures. He will talk about the ecosystem, the startup and venture capital investment ecosystem in Finland for a very short period, 10 minutes, I believe. Then we will move to Turkey. Another partner will speak up on a similar topic, and we'll continue with the other speakers. Okay, Mr. Petri, I see your face. The floor is yours, please.
Thank you very much. And thank you for the great opening. Cannot help thinking that the orchestra is a little bit like to have a startup. We need to have someone who has composed the music. We need to the players. We need perhaps someone providing the instruments. May that be the venture capitalist investing. But above all, we need the contactor, the entrepreneur, pulling all together and hitting the right tune as the orchestra did with us. I have few slides, thanks to the kind help of Finnish Venture Capital Association, to show where we are in venture capital / private equity in Finland. I've been in this business for 25 years, so I've seen couple of ups and downs, including the dot-com boom of 2000, Lehman Brothers 2010, and now COVID. So it seems that in roughly every 10 years, we will see a crisis. That is good to know that 2030, we are facing something else. But what I have also seen is the great ability of the companies and people to bounce back. You cannot keep good entrepreneur down. Let's see how the technique works. I had today my software updated in my laptop, and everything has been a little bit complicated after that, but let's see. Can you? Unfortunately, it seems that I'm not able to share the screen, but I tell what I was about to share. On statistics, if you think of the players in the field, we have the full chain from business angels. Finnish business angel community is one of the most active in Europe. Indeed, not only active, but one of the largest. I have been working with them for, well, 15 years. We used to run a small network, our own, where I was involved, and then merged with the FIBAN. Once again, the sign being that the good way to go away is to combine your forces and strength. Combining several business internet networks, we created a network that today has 650 members. There is also a personal note to Istanbul as regards the Intel activities. 2010, I participated in the annual event of European Business Intel Network in Istanbul. At the very time when we had the ash cloud from the Icelandic volcano. So I was stuck in Istanbul for 3 days, and I have to say, I rather enjoyed being stuck. It was springtime, as Halil said, extremely beautiful. The Finnish Venture Capital Association has today, if we think of actual investor members, exactly 39 investors that label themselves as VC, investing in the earliest phase or growth phase. And we have 39, incidentally the same number of members who are in later stage investments. So we have the full chain also there. And then we have a large number of private equity investors who invest at a later stage. And to give a flavor of the investment, typically angels invest 40,000 euros in a case. Our venture investors typically invest 800,000 in the case. And our later stage investors, private equity, invest in 5.5 million. In addition to that, we have quite active crowdfunding market. Crowdfunding companies last year raised something like 70 or 80 million euros for portfolio companies, including a couple of companies on our portfolio. And to build the chain even better, we have active IPO market for the First North Nasdaq. That really didn't exist 5 years ago. And fingers crossed, we are in the process of taking one of our companies public within the next 4 weeks, which also tells how the market works. That was a company that originally was university spin-out from Tampere. And they are also selling Turkish market is rather large for them, even though it's a small company. So that is also something that I would like to see more in the Finnish startup scheme, to reach out also the Turkish market. We haven't really realized how large a market we have there, and also as a gate further south and east. And therefore, I'm really happy to participate also this conference. All the way we can build networks between Finland and Turkey are to be encouraged. The VC funds have also been active in raising new capital. Almost 300 million was raised last year for new investments. And what pleases me, it's also been companies with different investment strategy. So if you have a good business idea, good team, most likely you are able to find an investor that likes your thesis. In addition, of course, we have the wonderful public support system in the form of Business Finland, both advice, but also capital in form of loans. So I would say that our system is, it's not perfect, it's well functioning. And we know that today is working less well than it will next year, because each year I see steps forward in the Finnish ecosystem. One of the challenges is that we ought to have it more internationalized. We have seen increasingly large rounds by foreign investors, large investors, but I would like to see more non-Finnish angels, non-Finnish smaller companies investing in Finland. And indeed, we are in talks with a couple of investors to achieve that. Number-wise, quite often, many of our number people, almost 300 companies at different cases, stages, got funded this year, or last year, a significant increase. And I would say that there is a clear trend, even though 2020 might be a bit of exceptional. However, this year has started well. There has been several rounds of in the magnitude of tens of millions or even 100 million. So we also see now large rounds coming to the market. There are a couple of rounds that are significant in size, even European standards. Wolt, the delivery company, food delivery company, has raised over 400 million this year. There are other companies that are in 100 range. But what we see more and more are investment rounds from 20 to 40 million. And I would like to see those rounds also be so that there are even more non-Finnish investors.
I have to interrupt you. I can share your presentation if it will be work for you.
Actually, no problem in that, because my time is just out.
Okay.
In a Finnish way, I had a timer there not to speak too long. But okay. I'm happy to answer all your questions in Q&A, and okay. Perhaps you can distribute the presentation to the participants afterwards. They okay. are quite self-explanatory. Yeah,
okay. If I may interject, if you need more time, Petri, we'll do it the Turkish way. We always give some bits of our time to our guests. So if you need a couple more minutes, please feel free.
No, okay? I'm fine to carry on. But you have through this conference also my contact information. So if you have any further questions or you need some assistance as regards how to enter Finnish markets, do not hesitate to contact me. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Petri Lane, and I appreciate your view on timing. I mean, timing is also important, and at the end, we'll probably have time. Now we'll move to the second speaker from Turkey. Probably most of you know our Turkish people, Mr. Burak Büyükdemir. He is, in fact, the founder of Startup Istanbul and Tohum, and he will talk for 20 minutes. Burak Bey, floor is yours.
Thank you, Ali Bey, and also Halil Bey for inviting me for this meeting. It's my pleasure today with you and excited to share my experiences with the Turkish startup ecosystem. Hi, I am Burak Büyükdemir. I am founder of Etohum and Turkey's leading acceleration program. And also we organize Startup Istanbul and Startup Turkey events. Since 2008, we have supported more than 400 startups in our programs. And also with our events, we have gathered thousands of entrepreneurs from different countries and investors globally. So today, today I'm going to share you about some quick facts that you already know, by the way, about Turkey. And then I will divide the Turkish startup ecosystem into two parts, and I will share what are the similarities and what have been activities in these years about the startup ecosystem in Turkey. And at the end, I will add my personal comment and give you about our Startup Istanbul event and also Hub of Istanbul. And at the end, I will summarize and give you some opportunities between Finland and Turkey. So let's start. Quick facts. As all you know, Turkey had an official population of 83 million. And we have a sizable young population and internet usage, by the way. And our half of the population is under age of 33 years old. I could easily say strong, young, technical and engineering talent with risk-taking appetite. Risk-taking appetite is higher than, I think, comparing to all Nordic countries, in my point of view. It's a perfect location, an attractive hub for startups. 3 hours by flight everywhere. all of the cities in Europe, Asia, Nordic Africa, and Middle East. By the way, this allowed us at Startup Istanbul event to gather and attract lots of startups and entrepreneurs and investors, many countries in the last 5 years. And culturally and historically, there is a connection between and close bonds with many countries. I mean, Istanbul is a mixture of many cultures. As probably you know, you have been to Istanbul many times. It's Europe, Asia, Middle East, and this attracts lots of startups and entrepreneurs for recent years. And also Istanbul is acting a regional hub for lots of multinationals. I mean, this is the easy background probably you all know. And this is our general conditions for the background. Now I will summarize the progress of Turkish startup ecosystem in last 20 years. And I will divide it to time frame into two parts. First wave in the Turkish startup culture was between 2000s and 2010s. And initial 10 years, very few entrepreneurship and funding activities, by the way. And talented entrepreneurs and founders has struggled a lot. Early success stories were established in those years, such as Yemek Sepeti, a food delivery company. It's a milestone of Turkish ecosystem in my point of view. It was founded in early 2000s and also acquired by Delivery Hero in 2015, nearly a valuation of $589 million. It's a very important startup in Turkish ecosystem. It's like PayPal mafia, and today's the founders are investing back to the ecosystem again. Also, Gitti Gidiyor, which was also founded in early 2000s, was acquired by eBay with a valuation of $200 million in 2011. So also we have some other examples such as Hepsi Burada, a leading e-commerce marketplace, and CareerNet, a job marketplace, search marketplace, Sahibinden, a leading classified. These all startups has been established and structured in the first wave, in the first half of the Turkish startup history. By the way, I was lecturing in 2006 and 2015 in Istanbul Technical University about entrepreneurship and e-business strategies, part-time lecturing. And by that time, it was very early. I have structured the first acceleration program at Etohum, 2008. 2008 was not only early years for Turkey, but also it was early years for most of the countries all over the world about the acceleration programs. It was popping up everywhere. So with this acceleration program and also with the early founders, we have also structured the first angel networks. And we have organized 500 events in Turkey and different parts of the world, such as San Francisco, London, Dubai, and Dublin. Also these events, not only ours, but also the universities and university clubs and other companies' events has triggered the other universities, media, and government departments to focus on more entrepreneurship in the first half of the history. So this is the especially very few events. And the second wave in the Turkish ecosystem, especially after 2010, lots of new VC funds has been structured. And this allowed many startups to access financing. And it was very important. I mean, there are many variables that makes startups successful, but finance is also one of the main criteria for most of the entrepreneurs, by the way. With a strong economic growth between 2010 and 2015, Turkey became a poster child for startup activities in the region and all over the world. Although there was a global financial crisis after 2008, all over the world, the amount of startups in Turkey increased. Most of the second wave successful startup stories began in this second half. Such as Peak Games, Trendyol, EasyCo, Insider, Gram Games. These are also the following successful startups. Also, Peak Games and Trendyol became unicorns. Peak Games was the first unicorn, and Trendyol also has been a great success story in Turkish ecosystem. We have now Getir, a food delivery company, also the third unicorn as well. Pick Game was a success story with a two big US hits. This is a gaming company, and it was Toy Blast and Toon Blast. And these global successful products are usually iterated in the domestic market. I mean, however, the local market is so big to sustain very large outcomes, even if the company and if the startup ultimately stays local without expanding internationally. And this is a blessing and curse. Because Turkey has a huge market, and also, and we wanted to go global, and most of the startup has these also challenges. Also, the Turkish entrepreneurs nowadays has positions to understand their need of to be global, by the way, with the help of these successful examples. And Trendyol is the second example, the great achievement. They are the unicorn status, and also they are focusing on the Turkish e-commerce opportunity. And these two examples, I mean, early two examples, has provided us the Turkish ambitious entrepreneurs and founders make it a great market, by the way. And this is mostly the second wave has effect on today's successful Turkish startup ecosystem. And beginning of 2010s, there were very few accelerators. I mean, in a decade, it increased to 60 and more now. And there are many technoparks, which enables tech companies to cluster in physical spaces. And government has many initiatives and support entrepreneurship activities, funds, and startups. And entrepreneurship education, which was an outlier for the early years, but now it is a part of the bachelor degree programs. There are many corporations supporting the startups and their programs, and also corporate venture capital entities are established in recent years. And government R&D supports and incentives, public and private universities, science and technology parks, providing a fertile ground for the innovation, by the way. And today we have more than 30 venture capital firms investing in Turkish startups. And I think there are more than 20 angel networks investing in early stage. Starting 2010, I mean, with the establishment of VC funds and angel networks, and also angel investors, accreditation of angel investors, and also increasing the acceleration programs, startup investments peaked in Turkey 2017. And the numbers of deals has increased tenfold in last decade. And not only the VCs were interested in this market, but they also invested in Turkish startups between 2018 and 19, which shows that many funds and investors believe in the potential of Turkish startups and putting their money behind that belief as well. So this is basically the Turkish history. And I would like to also mention about what we are doing as an acceleration program and Startup Istanbul event together, also not only Turkish startups, but also international entrepreneurs in Istanbul for the last 5 years. I mean, we have been an angel investor network and has been founded an acceleration program. And we have received nearly in last 10 years, 10,000 startup applications only from the Turkish market. But I mean, beginning with the last 5 years, with the help of Startup Istanbul event, we have also get applications from different countries. I mean, 170 countries. As I mentioned in the beginning of my presentation, Turkey is a nearly a gathering point, melting point, especially for the emerging markets and developing markets and Europe as well. So it's a geographically in the middle. So in 10 years, we have received nearly 10,000 applications from Turkish market, but last 5 years, we have received more than 200,000 tech entrepreneur applications from 170 countries. I mean, this also shows us that Istanbul can be a hub for the entrepreneurship center, international center. So we have also gathered lots of investors, speakers from Silicon Valley and European ecosystem. And also startups has applied from different countries, from Middle East to Asia, Africa, and Europe as well. And they have also received lots of funding after Startup Istanbul events. And our main idea is creating global startups and supporting them with network of mentors and finding their finance. This is our global, I mean, main idea at Startup Turkey and Startup Istanbul events. So I would like to sum up my presentation and our conversation with opportunities that may be leaving a room for investment opportunity for with philanthropic investors and also Turkish ecosystem. There are many underfunded high potential startups. Even though we have increased the number of funding, there is a high potential because still we have been level of local funding is significantly lacking. It is $1 per capita and leaving a room for investment opportunity and relatively underpriced entry valuations. I mean, in my point of view, this creates an exciting opportunity for cooperation between local funds and philanthropic investors to scale up Turkish companies and, I mean, philanthropic companies, startups globally. Thanks for inviting for me to this meeting. It was my pleasure today to be with you and share my experiences and short history of Turkish startup ecosystem.
Thank you, Burak Bey. In fact, we are four minutes. We have spare time for the cabin. Halil Bey, if you please yes. If you want to add comment on it.
I'm terribly sorry to actually to interrupt you, but can we have a piece of music in the meantime?
That would be splendid. Sure.
Okay. Evet, Emrullah'cığım orada mısınız?
While we are waiting, I have to congratulate Burak on what's been happening in Startup Istanbul.
Thank you very much for your nice feedback. And I will be very happy to also share more about Startup Istanbul and also startup ecosystem after this great meeting.
No doubt a LinkedIn invitation is on its way.
Great, perfect.
Ali Rıza'cığım, müsaadenizle. Emrullah'cığım, ekran sizin, sahne sizin. Ondan sonra, this is a way, Ali Rıza'cığım, this is a way to thank our first two speakers and to welcome our upcoming three speakers in two presentations, okay?
Great.
Haydi bakalım arkadaşlar. Teşekkürler Ali Rıza'cığım, sağ olun. Thank you. Evet, çok teşekkür ediyoruz Ali Rıza Hocam, çok teşekkürler. Evet arkadaşlar, sağ olun, var olun. Biliyorum ayrılmak zorundasınız ama her zaman olduğu gibi ruhumuza güzellikler kattınız. We thank our musicians for participating with us and joining our webinar and this program. Thank you so much indeed. So please feel free. Okay, thank you. Teşekkürler. Hocam, ekran yine sizin.
Çok teşekkür. Çok teşekkürler büyük üstadlar, hakikaten kulağımızın fası defalarca silindi. Well, what a great way to thank really our previous two speakers, Mr. Petri Lane and Burak Bey. Excellent presentations really, a nice overview of the both of the climates. Now we are our third presentation, a very challenging title indeed. Helsinki, the most connected startup ecosystem in the world. Surely the connection networking is very important in every field, and especially for innovation climate. So we will hear about those from Mr. Marco Tamminen. Sorry if I don't pronounce the names correctly. The Helsinki Business Hub, and Mr. Juni Lunasma, CEO of Startup Foundation. Floor is yours, please.
Teşekkür ederim, Ali Bey and Burak Bey for inviting us to speak. Merhaba. My name is Marko Tamminen from Helsinki Business Hub, and can I ask the organizer to share the presentation? Thank you. Teşekkürler. Next slide, please. So today I want to talk about Helsinki as an interesting opportunity for the Turkish startups and investors and companies, because this is the best kept secret in Europe, that Finland is actually attracting the most venture capital investment in Europe, 951 million euros raised in 2020. Like Petri mentioned, I show a few slides here just to ensure that you see the numbers. Helsinki is home to world-class startup events such as Lasson Arctic 15, and Jouni is going to talk a little bit more about those. And according to Startup Genome study, Helsinki and this ecosystem we have is number one locally connected in the world among founders, investors and experts. What it means in practice, we all help each other and work together to make startup success stories. And we also have a very good talent pool. I would say excellent talent pool because of the Finnish education system. So we have one of the most highly educated workforces in the world, and also the universities and the research and development organizations work very well together internationally, also with Turkey. Next slide, please. A recent example, I am the guy guy in the picture holding that sign. So we won the Israeli Innovation Ecosystem Awards, 50 ecosystems supplied globally, and Helsinki was chosen as the most innovative ecosystem in the world. And when we share the presentations, you are able to watch the video of the winning pitch. But our team was quantum technology, and this is a new fantastic opportunity, I think, a new phase of computing that's emerging, and Helsinki is leading in Europe with IQ and building the Europe's first quantum computer, and VTT, the Finnish Research Institute, investing 20 million into this quantum computer. But I will let you look at the video later, so let's not click that one yet. Let's move on in the presentation. So this is what Petri was referring to when he was saying that you know, Finnish startups are in fact receiving the most VC in Europe as a percentage of GDP. Next slide, please. And even during this COVID-19 crisis, we have seen continued investment from local investors and also international investors. So if you look at the bar for the 2020 on the right, you see that the foreign venture capital and foreign funding is 272 million out of the total bar, and other foreign investments, corporation angel funds, are 271. So we are heavily reliant on the foreign direct investment or foreign VCs, and I think this is also a good thing for Turkish investors, that you're able to partner with our investor ecosystem and do syndicate deals. And Petri is a great partner for you there, and the Finnish Venture Capital Association. Next slide, please. So what's the deal flow then? So we have startups, we have a high volume, and Helsinki Business Hub actually offers this deal flow service also to investors. We have about 1,600 startups in Helsinki and over 2,700 startups in Finland. They are making 14 billion euros in revenue. We have 600 deep tech startups. So the Helsinki ecosystem is really best in the deep tech areas like artificial intelligence, big data, smart and clean, sustainable green transition technologies, digital health or gaming. I mean, you have all heard these stories of companies like Rovio or Supercell producing video games, but I think what many people don't know, that there's a huge heritage of the Nokia legacy in Finland with wireless technologies, R&D organizations like Haltian doing product development with Oura ring manufacturers who are raising 100 million rounds. And there's many reasons that you should partner actually with Finnish startups to develop products or enter Europe via Finland, because we can be your gateway to Northern Europe. And this deep tech expertise is really, really valuable in startup ecosystem. So the like mentioned previously, we have a lot of startup capital access, and next slide, please. Next slide, please. So Helsinki Business Hub will help you enter Helsinki. So we offer market entry services both for startups and corporations and investors. So if you wish to find out more about this, can you go to next slide, please? We are able to offer several market entry options for you, establishment, M&A or capital investment, partnership or joint R&D projects. And next slide, please. So whoever is out there out of the 150 participants, I want to say, for startups and companies, we help you set up your business and find right business partners in our ecosystem. For investors, we help you give you direct deal flow services, and for companies we can also help you find reference markets and piloting opportunities, because we offer the city as a service, and we have many ecosystems like smart city and smart mobility ecosystems where we offer pilot platforms. So it's a nice way to enter the market, doing some real client pilots and then R&D collaboration and expand your business. Next slide, please. We focus mainly on these sectors, ICT, smart and clean and health, because they are the growth engines of the Finnish economy. And we have a good presence of the ecosystem partners. Next slide, please. In digitalization, we offer different ecosystems, and I can explain these in more detail to you. But good example is Finnish Center for Artificial Intelligence, where we can link the investors and startups and start looking at the portfolio opportunities. Next slide, please. So if you want to remember something from this presentation, is that we are the business advisors for the Helsinki ecosystem. Feel free to contact us. I am at your service. Teşekkürler. And then I leave the next part to Jouni. I'm 2 minutes over, but thank you.
Thanks a lot, Marco. Great presentation. I thought that I would share a few, let's say, more practical items on how to enter the Finnish ecosystem. I come from a company called the Startup Foundation. We are a non-profit organization supporting the growth of the Finnish startup ecosystem. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is fine. So we mainly operate through our daughter companies that are, I will in a brief moment talk about Slush, which is the big startup event. But then we also have a company called Junction organizing big hackathon events like global hackathon events. There is a company called The Shortcut, which is helping especially immigrants and foreign people to get kind of accustomed and enter the like networks and get training for starting their own companies. We have a student led and run a small VC operation called Wave Ventures, and then we are a shareholder in Maria 01, which is a large startup campus, and I'll come back to that as well. But in all, we are trying to promote the startup ecosystem and look for new ways to grow it. And I will now move to presenting the Slush event a little bit, and we have a short video about it. So if it's possible for you to run the video, please. The voice doesn't seem to be getting through.
Aycan Bey, share sound yapabilir misiniz?
But I suppose, Jouni, you could say a few words about Slush.
I can tell. Yeah, you can see the video and I can tell. So it's the biggest startup event in the whole of the Northern Europe. Gathering like a lot of if we move back to the slides so I can speak from there, gathering like a lot of investors, startup companies, international media. The last successful Slush event was organized obviously 2019. Then it was more than 25,000 people. Now for the obviously last year, because of the COVID, we were not able to organize it. Now the plan is to run it again in in beginning of December in Helsinki, and coming back from the COVID, the point here is really to look at like kind of a post-COVID way of viewing things, and we're now calling it the Renaissance of Entrepreneurship, where we are looking especially at three topics which are kind of relevant from the Finnish ecosystem point of view, but I believe have more general bearing as well. So where one is the diversity, at least from our perspective, there's definitely a need for greater diversity among the founders, among the investors, so that not all the entrepreneurs would be young men, but there would be like really a lot of different founders. Another one which is especially driving the young people is the kind of interest towards purpose-driven companies, obviously trying to tackle the climate change especially and other global challenges. And the third, like a really big opportunity, is the science and science-based entrepreneurship and like deep tech companies. And we are now starting to see the rise of these companies, and the event wants to support these trends as well. Next slide, please. So here's the plan for December. We are, because of the COVID, obviously we are running a little bit smaller event, but where we want to still have a lot of founders, really focus on founders and investors, reaching for like really like global audience of investors from Europe, from Silicon Valley and elsewhere as well. Next one, please. Here is some of the opportunities to participate to Slush. So obviously to attend the main event, then we are offering partners for boost and visibility. A lot of side events and workshops are happening at the same time. And for investors, there's a great screening and matching service, because the Slush has been such a success that the database for startups is really, really like a very, very big one. And there's a lot of experience in running matching services for investors and corporates. Next one, please. So this is in like towards the topic for the next one. And the video, I can share it in the chat. You can have a look at with the sound. It's really been an event where there's a lot of effort in making it interesting for the participants and immersive, if you will. Next one, please. I will now briefly also talk about the Maria 01 campus that is the largest startup campus in Finland and Northern Europe. We have like about close to 200 companies now, with more than 1,000 people working in those companies in the premises. Next one, please. The idea is to bring together in the same campus startups, investors, corporates, and different accelerators and facilitators, where each one is then like getting the benefit of the networks, and there's more than well. Next one, please. So this is like really we have a selection criteria for the companies, so to really get and attract the best companies and technologies. Next one, please. This is the criteria for the company, so it needs to be scalable. The product is there, or at least there's like an MVP of the product. The companies need to be like generating cash flow, or then there's like funding, sufficient funding, and then there's a strong team. Next one, please. And like the companies are already like interesting a lot of capital to them. Next one, please. What might be interesting to you as well is that the the campus, there's a major expansion plan of the campus, and the current one is built in an old hospital, so it looks quite different from this, but in the same physical area there will be an expansion which is going to be really large, which means that it will be three times as large with over 500 startups and scale-ups in the future. Next one, please. And here is just kind of a sketch of it. The yellow ones are the buildings that are currently on site and that are now in use, and then the white ones are the expansion plans that then the building is planned to start already next year, so that is really an ambitious plan. And next one, please. And I suppose Marco, if you want to close up from here, that would be great. Thanks for your interest.
Yes, thank you, Jouni. So if you wish to enter Helsinki, we can offer business information services, tailored fact-finding tours, matchmaking, access to financing, introductions to international investors, soft landing services, access to deal flow, partnering opportunities, access to innovation platforms, and corporate startup collaboration opportunities. Next slide, please. So you can contact me, my contact details are here, or if I'm not available, my colleague Sandeep Shah, or you can also contact Jouni. So I have put Jouni's contact details there. So we are your local guides to business in Helsinki. So thank you very much for this opportunity to speak to you today. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Marco and Jouni, really. I predicted as a very challenging title, and it deserves the title, surely. And I'm sure there may be quite a few burning questions, but let's delay them to the end and move on to use the time properly. The last speaker is from Turkey again, Mr. Melih Aksan, and he will talk about the legal infrastructure for startup and technology companies. Melih Bey, buyurun.
Thank you so much. Thank you for the opportunity. So I'll try to give a little bit insight about how legalities work in Turkey, how integrated our system is with the rest of the world. Because sometimes Turkey is perceived as, you know, a little bit exotic maybe to the eyes that are not familiar. But, you know, I would like to start by mentioning that the Turkish legal system is mostly harmonized with the EU laws, because, you know, about, I guess, almost 19, 20 years ago, there had been really, the Republic was founded by, you know, literally translating laws from Germany, Switzerland, Italy. But, you know, in the past 20 years or so, almost, there had been a lot of effort to harmonize the laws with the EU in the way of full accession to the EU, the ambition of Turkey to get into EU. So at the moment, I can safely say that about the matters that can concern a startup or an investor, a startup investor, such as angel investors, venture capital funds, and others, I can say that what the legal system in Turkey is what, you know, like 99% similar to what they would get in the EU or in the US. You know, it's harmonized mostly. So, for example, also it is possible to, you know, have you know, foreign courts or foreign arbitration centers to be designated as dispute resolution mediums in the contracts, and they are fully enforceable in Turkey. So in that regard, also there is the harmonization and you know, easy to defend the rights in case of any disputes. Also, you know, in many MENA countries or Gulf countries, Arab countries, you would see rules, you know, you would see some exotic rules such as, you know, you gotta have a local partner when you want to set up a company in such countries, you know, a local citizen should have own a certain percentage of the shares whatsoever. Turkey doesn't have such rules. So it's very, it's a free market. The rules are transparent, accessible. I think it's good enough to feel safe. Other than that, well, usually in Turkey, I guess the rest of the legal problems would be similar to what other startups in the world would have. You know, since startup kind of means that, you know, you gotta be as per some definitions from some famous professors, it's gotta be disruptive. So it's gotta be doing what it does at least maybe 10 times better than the conventional system. And if you are disrupting in such a big way, startups usually wander around the gray areas of law. So, because to earn that competitive edge, to earn that disruptive edge, usually they are also playing at the edges of the legal system sometimes, but it's quite often in my experience. So it's really critical for them to sit down with the lawyers and design the legal infrastructure in a way that's compliant with the regulations, because as you all know, it doesn't really change a thing whether the entity is a startup or a big corporation. You know, if they have to be in line with, in compliance with the consumer laws, for instance, they gotta be compliant with this consumer laws regarding the size of the company. But in the Turkish culture, there's still a transformation that's going on in the perception of the legal assistance, legal services. When I talk to people, you know, they would approach me like the founders, let's say, you know, I did nothing wrong. I mean, I don't have any disputes. Why do I need a lawyer? I mean, I don't have a lawsuit going on. But actually, the culture of having a lawyer at the side, like an accountant, you know, from day one, to keep everything in check, is critical. To stay compliant is critical. Because sometimes, you know, like if it's a software as a service or if it's a consumer oriented product, sometimes, you know, there could be like hundreds, thousands, tens of thousands of contracts that can be entered into on their systems. And for example, if they are not fully compliant with the consumer laws, let's say, they could be subject to really high amounts of penalties. So it's really critical or they may be trying to do some line of business that's not permissible by law at all. So it's really critical to have a lawyer on the side. Well, in Turkey, the funds, the whole setting up a fund, setting up a venture capital fund system has been rehauled recently, and it was made really attractive both for foreigners and the local investors, in my opinion. And also there are the government is currently really incentivizing setting up funds. They're also incentivizing setting up startups, obviously. But as a tool of this, as an instrument of that, they're also encouraging people to set up funds, venture capital funds in Turkey. And the way of such incentives is to that they the government fund the government has fund of funds. They directly put money into funds through some programs. You know, if you get accepted, they put funds into your prospective fund, and also there are huge tax incentives for such Turkish funds set up in Turkey. Such as, you know, exemptions from corporate tax at the level of the fund. Of course, these are all some certain subjects. These are all subject to certain terms and conditions. But, you know, both at the level of the fund and both also when the money will return back to the investors, there are really attractive tax incentives. So I could easily say that, safely say that in Turkey, setting up a fund is really heavily incentivized. In Turkey, the investments are made mostly, I mean, if you think on the system of percentages, like I can say that 80% of, let's say, you know, roughly, in my experience, according to my observations, let's say 70 to 80% of the investments are made through the conventional contribution into a capital increase at the company. So, you know, take the money and give a percentage of shares that are agreed based on the valuation. But as you're all aware, sometimes the valuation for early stage startups is not really, you know, cannot be determined so easily, cannot be easily evaluated. And around the world, the system called, you know, convertible notes or, you know, convertible bonds, equity are utilized. In Turkey, you know, they are also utilized, but the legal system, the legal infrastructure for such instruments, I cannot say they're fully at the optimal, at the perfect levels. But I see that such arrangements are sometimes being made, and they're, you know, for especially for the venture capital funds that are set up in Turkey as per the relevant regulations. Such convertible documents are recognized as an instrument that such funds can use to invest in startups. As I said, the startups in Turkey, I see that, you know, just to give you some insight about the culture that reigns in Turkey at this moment, I see that they don't really include legal costs at their budgets when they're seeking investments. mostly, of course, there would be some startups that are set up by more experienced people, you know, former C-level executives whatsoever. They are aware of how important it is to have the legal affairs sorted out. But most of the times, you know, what we get are young people, university graduates, and so they would write down marketing costs, you know, development costs whatsoever. But you know, they wouldn't usually include legal costs. But we are trying to, you know, train, educate the ecosystem by way of, you know, entering into mentoring programs. I'm for example, you know, I have positions, I have, you know, duties in some accelerator programs, some incubation centers. I go and make presentations and explain them about why legal affairs are also so important and should not be taken lightly. Apart from that, One of the participants mentioned about crowdfunding, how it's popular in Finland. In Turkey, recently, the relevant laws and regulations were overhauled, and you know, they added equity based and you know loan based. We are in the process of fully making them fully functional in Turkey. The laws are being studied, and the government has the plans to fully enact laws to allow both the loan based, the merit based, the equity based types of crowdfunding. And they you know it is currently possible to set up crowdfunding platforms also in Turkey. So I think we'll see day after day an increase in using such means, the crowdfunding line as well, to invest in startups in Turkey. Other than that, you know, what usually makes Turkey attractive is the talent is relatively affordable, but it's really high quality in terms of technical talent. Interestingly, even as a law firm, we've been visited by certain people, you know, mostly from the United States, that were looking for development houses, you know, developers or other technical people to, you know, source such workforce for the American startups. It's quite interesting. I asked them, you know, why do you prefer Turkey over, I don't know, if it's about the costs, you know, why not India or Pakistan or whatsoever? And the reply I would get would be, the level of quality and the approach of Turkish talent to problem solving, you know, they would usually have more of an open mind, more of a creative mind. So that's an interesting thing. And also Turkey acts as a good, you know, to open up the for example, if a Finnish startup would want to expand into Turkey, It's such a big market, such a young market, and the internet penetration is really high. I believe it's a good place to test and test and develop the application, and also, you know, to earn good money due to the size of the market. It should be really attractive. Also, you know, occasionally, not occasionally, but you know, the main line of foreign investments into Turkey comes through foreign venture capital funds, and also we would see later stage startups, you know, scale ups, or you know, even higher end corporations. The major players from EU, from the US, we would see them entering the Turkish markets by acquiring a local startup, and you know they would instantly start being active in the market. And I think they had quite of a success. You know, for example, as Burak mentioned, the acquisition of Yemeksepeti, a food delivery service by Delivery Hero, or acquisition of the gaming companies. You know, there have been unicorns from the Turkish ecosystem, and I think they've been really happy with their investments, as far as I know. Lastly, you know, as I said, as Turkey is, you know, mostly harmonized with the European laws, legal system, you would see that EIF, EBRD, and you know, some other European major investors, banks, sometimes investing into funds that are active in Turkey, investing into Turkey. I think, you know, that's a demonstration of the trust, in my opinion, at least, and that, you know, Turkey is an investable country. I think that's pretty much it at the moment, for the moment. I would happily take questions if you would have in the quick Q&A session. I know I'm a little bit, you know, 4 minutes behind, but I think we pretty much covered many topics, but please let me know if you have any questions about the legal matters in Turkey, how it works. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Melih Bey. Well, presentations all were very flourishing and stimulating. We have 15 minutes scheduled for Q&A session and final remarks. I'm sure Halil Bey would wrap up the session. Halil Bey, how should we do it? Would you like to comment?
Well, let me get some help from Aijan Bey. Aijan Bey, do we have some specific questions on the question and answer box and the chat box?
Yes, please, you can write your questions to Q&A menu. Also, we have one question regarding energy cooperation coming from Mr. Mark Popo. He asks, is there any focus on energy sensitive topics and potential discussions on cooperation in this field between Turkey and Finland? Perhaps Halil Bey, you would like to add something on that, because it is not directly related to startup ecosystems.
It is not, but we definitely have energy related startups in Finland and in Turkey. So I will first pass the, I see that nodding of the head, Yoni. Would you please mention a few words over there, and then I can add a few things if there's time. Okay, please. You're muted. You're muted. This is.
Sorry. Yeah. I can note that. Yeah. That definitely is energy related innovation activities. So, for example, in the Maria Startup Campus, there is one of the major energy companies in Finland. They have like their own investment program and startups that are located in the campus. So that is one thing. Then the City of Helsinki Energy Company, they are running an acceleration program as well. Then there is in Vaasa region, there is a lot of activity around like energy cluster on like different manufacturing technologies related to energy. And then I know that there is now, they are building some like battery related, like also industrial facilities close to Pori. So there's innovation around that. So at least those are a few things that come to my mind. Maybe somebody would want to compliment.
Marco, just put in a comment there. Would you like to talk about that, please?
Yeah. I put in a comment there that Helsinki has a lot of innovation ecosystems around energy, and you can have a look in more detail under the link. Basically, there's multiple companies in infrastructure and electricity distribution, research and development, innovation, and also a lot of startups in this sector, and EU is investing about €1 trillion in green transition funding in EU Horizon funding. So this is also nice opportunity to get some public soft funding for green transition. And most of the energy companies in Finland have their own venture capital fund, like Helen Ventures or Fortum Valo Ventures. And they have been preparing for the transition from fossil fuel-based energy forms. And this is creating very good, I think, cross-border investment opportunity. This is an area we can explore in more detail if you like. And I have provided some more information there on the chat. Thank you.
Thank you.
Maybe Burak Bey, is Burak Bey available? Is here Burak Büyükdemir Bey? Yeah. Burak Bey, would you like to comment on Startup Istanbul and Etohum, the companies? Because I know we also have in Turkey quite a bit of energy conservation related startups.
Great question. I was also thinking about the answer for that. And also, I have also received an email about the question itself. Most of the VCs in Turkey are generalist, and also they are not directly investing in verticals nowadays because our ecosystem is growing. We have also increasing number of energy startups, especially in the pre-seed and seed stage coming. But I mean, I don't know exactly the statistics or exact data for the energy startups.
Well, I have a feeling that this is a great opportunity for blending Finnish and Turkish companies and investors in our proposed North-South corridor. In fact, I'd like to add a few comments here because I saw some questions related to the answers that I'm going to give right now, I'm going to share with you now. When we wanted to do a program, a webinar, on startup ecosystems, we thought it would be better to have an initial webinar first to lay the ground, to lay the foundation, okay? Hopefully, very soon, maybe even within the next 4 to 6 weeks, we'll have a follow-up meeting before the summertime, June 21st, before June 21st in Finland, where we'll have interconnected meetings. We will bring Finnish and Turkish companies and investors together. So the first half will be even a shorter version of presentations. And the second half will be bringing and matching these companies, okay? I mean, I know one company where our group has an option and this company is actually in the area of storage, energy storage, heat storage, which I think is a very novel from Finland, okay? And also another company where we have very strong relations, they are entering the Turkish steelmaking market. And one of the ultimate objectives is to conserve energy in the arc furnaces in steelmaking processes, okay? And I know in Turkey, there are many young entrepreneurs who are in very effective areas of energy storage and energy conservation. So I think this can be a great topic along with what we proposed on ComTech, construction technologies and PropTech. So thank you again for these questions. Any of the other panelists would like to make any comments? Ajahn, maybe we can move to the next question.
Yeah, well, there's a comment from Mr. Fatih Yücel. He says, I believe it is about Melih Bey's speech. The notification for crowdfunding based on share is declared. So maybe
Melih Bey. Yes. Of course. I mean, it was in the official gazette, and sorry if caused a misunderstanding. It's already enacted, the equity-based crowdfunding, but the actual activities are still taking pace. That's what I meant.
In 2000, I'd like to add, thank you, Melih Bey. Aziz Arjan, with your permission, please, okay? I'd like to add a few other comments from the past and bring it to the present time. In 2007, we organized a very interesting forum at DAEIC, Istanbul Forum on Education, Technology and Innovation. At that time, I was the coordinating chairman of Turkey Central European Councils, which included Estonia, all the Latvia, Lithuania, all the Baltic countries, and came all the way down to Bulgaria, 10 countries, okay, in that north-south corridor. And that's how the inspiration actually came around, along with the 800th anniversary of our Rumi, inspired by Rumi. It was a very successful event, but we also had friends from Finland. And what we suggested, again, this north-south corridor, okay, because what I've realized at that time, along with my colleagues and friends, that as we moved north, there was more innovation and design, especially in the heydays of earlier Nokia. Design was big, still is big, by the way. And Nokia is also doing great. That's another story, success story of coming back. But then we can address those later on in some other programs. As we went north, innovation and design was becoming very apparent and strong. But as we came down, especially when we reached Turkey, there was a lot of inherent and natural entrepreneurial spirit. Now, what I'm seeing over the past 14 years, Finland has really made a big way. I really congratulate you all. Slush is truly a world-class worldwide event. And I did participate in Slush, also the side events of Slush in 2019. And I was actually with a delegation on Maria 01, very impressive. And now I see that you're doing more activities there. But we have a lot of unheard and unseen and undiscovered potential in Turkey, okay? For us, entrepreneurship is very natural, it's here. And I still believe that we're born entrepreneurs, okay? And I wanna emphasize again, and again, I appreciate it, all of your participation, and Burak Bey, we need to make sure that we go together to Finland and talk about Startup Istanbul. And would like to have our friends Marco and Yoni more often here. So like we are trying to blend human and machine intelligence in the day and age of artificial intelligence, we have to really blend our talents. So this activity is, in my opinion, is the start of HISU, Helsinki Istanbul Startup Union. And what do we need? We need all those spirits. And what we need as well, SISU, never give up. SISU for HISU, okay? Let's coin this term, all right? And please make a note of this. Helsinki Istanbul Startup Union. Do we agree on this, dear panelists? Yeah. Adriza,
yeah. Let's work on this. Really nicely put out. So thanks a lot.
And the other thing is, our partner in our activities is Business Finland. I'm impressed with their work, with their approach. I want to thank every single person in Business Finland. This one, the leader there was Mr. Talha Daye. Talha'cığım teşekkür ediyorum. But also we have Nilüfer Hanım and Pelin Hanım and the whole team, our ambassadors and also commercial attachés are very active. I want to thank them all for their participation. In fact, I see that our ambassador, His Excellency Baku Erkul is here, and our commercial attaché. I mean, I get confused with those terminologies, but Nisa Hanım is also here. And thank you again very much for the support. So this is what I want to say, okay? Hocam, buyurun lütfen. Adil
Bey, I totally agree with you. In fact, I really liked your abbreviation. Helsinki Istanbul Startup Union. And I agree with you on the undiscovered potential. There is recalling my students at the university, and some of them really started up their own companies, and not only in Turkey, internationally, And I think, well, if Halil Bey mentioned about our program, graduate executive program, a lot of youngsters, they after our program, they stopped their professional life. I mean, they changed their professional life into with a new startup spirit. They go into new fields. I wonder, I mean, time is really running out, but how about the future? You mentioned about the Renaissance. I mean, I'm curious how pandemic really had an influence on this culture, the ecosystem, and what would be the future? You talked a little bit about the technology, at least you mentioned machine learning, artificial intelligence, blockchain. I mean, the entrepreneurship really just based on those technology driven, or it may be, for instance, social innovation, other kinds. And Turkey would be, the Anatolia would be a real testbed, because we feel the urgency of need really to do a lot of things, and we rely on our youngsters. I would like to get your opinion about the future of entrepreneurship and startup, if you would like to share your thoughts. Any?
Marco, well, I can go first. I think it's a very good question, and I love the Renaissance, because like Leonardo da Vinci, he was a multi-talented individual, and as an entrepreneur, you need to be multi-talented individual, and you need to be able to, in the modern technologies, digitalization, be able to, you know, sculpture and create products, services, on the fly based on human needs. You need to be able to combine the technical and the business, the kind of the social and the psychological views and politics. And I think it's very apparent in this day and age with the COVID-19 that most companies have now in practice faced digitalization, that now today we are doing this webinar on video, and we're able to do this very well. And this is something that is really great time for entrepreneurs, because it's now possible to start a global business and build a global team. And there's less barriers to entry, actually, because everybody is equal online. So I think this is a golden time for digital entrepreneurship. It's a modern renaissance.
I very much agree with what Marco said. And then I think there's another great like similarity, that also nowadays, like in the Renaissance time, it was a lot was built around cities, where the cities were really the driver. And I think this is the same now, the ecosystem is happening in startups and the whole innovation is happening in cities. And I think like connecting these hubs and leading cities around the world is the way to like really make faster progress. So I very, very much thank you for having us to here at the great webinar to talk about the things and maybe put the start to the HISU program, connecting the cities.
Yes. Why not? And we will do it. We'll make it happen. And I just wrote on the chat, I want to thank all the contributors to make HISU happen. That this is the birthday of HISU, okay? May 6th. Very good. Aziz Arjan, please.
So, I don't know whether we have time.
Ajan Bey, how are we doing with time? I think we are 5 minutes past. I think we can perhaps end our session. Yes, or do we have one more question?
We have two more questions actually, but quite brief ones. Our Finnish guests would like to answer, one participant would like to know about the tech-driven entertainment projects, especially aiming at kids' content and animations. And the second question is how many Turkish business investors invested in Finland's startup ecosystem last year. If there's any data that you can share, we appreciate it. But I don't know if you have it. Okay. These are the final two questions.
Marco, would you have any data on
that? Yeah, I'm just thinking that I don't have specific data on how many Turkish investors invested in Finnish startups, but I think it's possible to dig that data out from Finnish Venture Capital Association statistics because they keep track of the statistics. So we can find out if you want.
But of course, dependent on where the companies would be registered. So like it's not always the same as where the funds are registered as to who is behind them. So
okay, how about tech driven entertainment industry? Could you please elaborate on that as well?
Well, the are you discussing telecom, media, entertainment sector investments? So investments into the tech sector companies. I think that's the majority of the investments because the venture capital investments are deep tech in nature. So it would be majority of the investments, but I don't have the data here to give you the exact figures.
Then specifically about the entertainment, I would say the games are the number one. Other than that, there's not really that much in the Finnish ecosystem. But obviously, games are big, and there's dedicated funds and like Supercell is investing, and there's also other new funds in that area. So I'd say that's the number one for the entertainment side.
Well,
yes, sir.
Please.
Yeah, it's just the video gaming ecosystem is very exciting one from investor perspective. I think you could, as an investor, easily look at it from Finland because Finland has a global, very, very good quality ecosystem for gaming. And it's totally scalable globally and very high margin business for those games that become successful. And companies like Electronic Arts have kind of an office in Helsinki. And it's not a coincidence. And the Maria Zero one that Jouni was speaking about, this facility, the biggest startup hub in Northern Europe, it's the place where most of these companies are located. So it's a really great ecosystem. And I wish you could all come visit us in Helsinki and see the Supercell headquarters. They are building it from a wood in the city center of Helsinki. They are building like a fantasy building from wood in the city. So that's Renaissance too.
Very good, very good. This is very, we will definitely follow you up on that and we'll come to Helsinki as soon as the pandemic allows us to travel back again, okay? Like the good old days. Well, Ali Rıza Hocam, with your permission, I'd like to take it over. And I wanna thank you first for being with us, for spending your time for us. And I want to thank all the speakers for impressive presentations. I want to thank all participants. And again, my team, all those people who really helped me make this happen in DAEİK. Aycan Bey, teşekkür ederim. Dilek Hanım, teşekkür ederim. And all the invisible heroes of DAEİK. And of course, my executive board of directors, starting with my vice presidents, vice chairman. Onur Bey was very active, Onur Çakır, in helping us preparing, and Evren Dindiren Hanım is always very helpful, and the rest of my team in the board. I want to thank once again to Business Finland and everybody involved. This has been a great startup, I think. And let's say long live Hisu, okay? Okay, thank you very much and lots of love from a great spring afternoon in Istanbul. Okay, don't forget, spring is the time for growth. Do you want to grow? Yes, we agree, right? We want to grow with Hisu. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Teşekkürler.
Kitos, kitos.
Thanks to everybody. Bye bye.
Thank you.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.